Satan's power when we were gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. He has come for us, this Jesus. He's the hope for all mankind. He has come for us, the Messiah, born to give us life.
There were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." The stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's.
to be our friend.
Well, thank you all for being with us this evening. I'd like to wish you a very Merry Christmas. My name is Eddie Bevel. I'm one of the pastors here. And thank you for sitting close to your neighbor today. We appreciate that. Hope that you're having a wonderful and blessed Christmas season, and that this evening will be a part of that, and also that tomorrow will be a nice crescendo to your experiences. I need some help. I'm wondering if I could ask my younger friends in the room, all of the children, if they could join me up here for a little while on the floor. All the children, can you come up and sit with me while we talk about a very important story? Yep, that's good. Just make your way, find a spot on the floor. That's great. That's great. Come on up, guys. Parents can come too. That's great. Yep, just cram on in. We have a few seats over here too if you want to get closer. That's good. All right. Is everyone having a good Christmas so far?
Yeah.
That's good. That's good. Are you all expecting gifts tomorrow?
Yes.
Just letting you know. That's great. Well, why do we celebrate Christmas? Who knows? Yes.
Because it's about when Jesus was born in the manger.
That's right. That's right. When Jesus was born in the manger. And where did Jesus come from? Where was he before he was on earth? Yes. He was with God in heaven. That's right. That's where Jesus was. And so he came to earth. And we like to think of Christmas as a time where we receive the greatest gift of all, Jesus. All right? Yes?
Yes. If you give presents for Jesus, it's baby Jesus' birthday.
That's right. It's baby Jesus' birthday. So I want you to help me tell the story of Jesus' birth. It was very unique and different. And the Bible tells the story. In fact, just a little while ago, our friend Bethany, who is leading us in worship, she read the story from the book of Luke about the coming of Jesus, the coming of the Christ child. And I have with me a nativity set. Now, over 30 years ago, my wife and I got married. We were four when we got married. No, not really. Not really. We weren't, I promise. But we took a trip during our first year of marriage to the country of Israel, and we went to the city of Bethlehem. And while we were in Bethlehem, we bought this nativity set, okay? And this nativity set is from Bethlehem, and it's made of olive wood, very special wood tree that you find in Israel. So I want you to help me. I'm going to pull out the different pieces. Shh, girls, girls, shh. No questions now. You can put your hands down. That's awesome. Just listen. Okay. I want you to help me name the different pieces of the nativity set, okay? So I'm going to pull something out and you tell me what it is. We'll start with this. What is that?
A sheep.
A sheep. That's right. They are not proportionate. I apologize, but it's a sheep. Okay. And let's see what else we have. Aha. What is this?
Cow.
Cow. I think it's cow. Okay. All right. Anybody know what this is?
Manger.
And what is a manger?
Something that horse feeds out of.
Right. It's what the animals eat from. The horse feeds from it. That's right. That's the manger. It's a fancy one with, looks like olive branches or something. Okay. What do we have here?
Sheep.
Yeah, it's not a trick question. We have more than one sheep. Yeah, it's good. Very astute group. Okay, what about, let's just get these guys out of the way first. Anybody know who these guys are?
Wise men.
Yep. They weren't really at the birth, but we're going to celebrate them anyway. Okay. What about, aha, what is this?
A donkey.
Had to think, didn't you? Yeah, it's a little confusing, but that's donkey. Very good. Okay. Looks a little bit like a small dog, but it's a donkey. Okay. Who do you think this guy is?
Joseph.
Yep. I think that's a shepherd. I think that's one of the shepherds. This is all a little bit of a guess, but we're going to guess shepherd there. We're also going to guess shepherd for this older guy. He's an older shepherd. And then we have a third shepherd. There are a lot of sheep, a lot of shepherds. That's how it goes. Okay. Who do you think this might be?
Joseph.
Yep. I think that's Joseph. And what about this?
Mary.
Right. That's Mary. And last but certainly not least. Baby Jesus, that's right. So when baby Jesus was born, it was a very special night. Now, in a moment, I'm going to read a story for all of us to hear that the shepherds may have thought as they went through the process of seeing this. But one of the great things to understand about the coming of the Christ child is that God himself left heaven to come to us because he loved us so much. He lived a perfect, sinless life, meaning he never did anything wrong. Wow. I've done some things wrong. Have you done some things wrong?
Yes.
Good answer. So true. So true. And then at the end of his life, he died on the cross and he paid for all of my sin and all of your sin, so that we could be forgiven of our sin and spend eternity with God in heaven. That's the good plan that he has for us. And it began on earth when the baby came. So tomorrow, when you're maybe around the Christmas tree at your house, if you have one of those, or maybe you're exchanging gifts, because how many of you think you're getting gifts tomorrow? Okay, yeah, all of you. So as you're giving gifts and receiving gifts, remember that the real reason for Christmas, it's not about loving each other. It's not about eating your favorite food. It's not about singing songs around the tree. All those things are fun. There's nothing wrong with those things. But the real reason for Christmas is to celebrate Jesus. That's right. That's exactly right. It's all about Jesus. Let's pray, boys and girls. Lord, thank you for loving us. Thank you for coming to us when we so needed a Savior. And I pray for any of these children and any of the other people in the room who maybe don't know you yet as Lord and Savior. I pray that you will bring them to an understanding, grow them in their faith, and help them to trust you as Lord and as Savior. That they would trust you, the baby, that they would trust you, the God of gods, the King of kings, the Lord of lords, the Savior of the world. And I pray it in your name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, guys. You can go back to your seats now. So it's always interesting. You never know what they're going to say, right? But it was obvious that they, for the most part, knew the story. It's exciting to see that in children, to know that they know about Jesus. I want to read to you from the book of Matthew briefly. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son. You shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet, which is, behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son. They shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. That's been the theme of our messages this month as we've been considering the very presence of God in our lives. When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. Matthew chapter 1. I want to share with you a story written actually by a doctor in Nashville, and I was just so encouraged by it as I read it, I wanted to share it with you. It's entitled Reflections of a Shepherd. Reflections of a Shepherd. There are moments in every person's life when the truth comes fresh without the usual noise, received in a new way, as if for the first time. This is how things went down for me. Thank you for listening. Another night working, another week far from home. I lost count how many days I had been away this time on the job. Bone tired, joints ached, that nagging cough, boredom setting in. If I am troubled, how about my wife? She keeping everything going at home while the growing kids' lives are more at a distance. Not sure my challenges compare to hers. Such appraisals are to be avoided. Comparisons unintentionally foster distance between us. Oh well, another night. The sheep corralled, canvassing the landscape for intruders, trying not to be annoyed by my fellow shepherds, expecting not much except the next moment's disappointment. It is a life. It is my life. On nights like these, I get around to thinking about God, at least a little. How else to explain the delicacy of one blade of grass upon the occasional patches of meadow in this dusty region? Glimpses of his invisible attributes and divine nature, clearly seen being understood through what has been made. So I guess I am without excuse. But I have questions. I have issues. What would he have to do with me? I'm just a shepherd trying to put a day together. Never have amounted to much, never have really done anything bad, not religious, just a regular Joe. Never made much of those who call themselves orthodox, who seem to have it all together and gaze at me with disdain as if I needed help. How did they get so disappointed in me? Is God upset too? Those people are probably right, but I find them confusing and arrogant. They have a lot of explaining to do, such as, why do we suffer so? Why all the heartache? Why do we work so hard? And for what? The harvest being scarcely justified of the effort made in sowing the seed. I earn wages, but it is as if there's a hole in my pocket. I shiver in the promises of better times that never come. Any spiritual input is swallowed up in lifestyle where the demands on me outmatch spiritual output. No inspiration, dull, bored, and tired. And so, I keep doing things my way. Yet deep inside, I think I know that there is an order of God. And those who practice independently from Him are worthy of death. But I just go on doing the same, and I approve of my shepherd buddies who practice likewise. But everything changed that night. The angel of the Lord suddenly stood before us, and the glory of the Lord shone around us. In an instant, I was paralyzed. Time halted. This was the most dramatic light show that ever took place. Heaven breaking loose, the glory of God, the radiant, unveiled magnificence of God filled the sky. The otherness, the purity, the beauty of God, the one who can't be studied empirically, He is so other that we can never pretend to predict what He will do or get Him under our control in any way. Magical, mesmerizing, wooing me, right? No, not really. You probably wish you were there, don't you? Then you would believe, wouldn't you? Well, this is how messed up I am. Even then, at that instant, I became sad and scared. Two reasons come to mind. First, it wouldn't stick. Here we go again. A flash of God's brilliance that just flickers away, soon to be forgotten. I've been terrified by God plenty, and to be painfully honest, it never did much good. I've been undone by the magnificence of the birth of my children, above my pay grade when I stop and consider what it takes to hold the seasons together, to bring forth a new day, to allow my brain to crackle along, terrified by my own mortality, seeing the pain, suffering, and death all around me. You'd think this would be good, that I'd finally get it right. Nope. Sadly, that state of being terrified can give way to a state of dullness. His transcendence, his otherness, only proves that he doesn't relate to me. Too personal and unknowable, and too distant to care and to comfort. Just the man upstairs, who I called on as a kid to help me win a game. A blaze of glory lasts for a moment. Then I usually get back to work. After all, I've seen the latest fads. They don't last. Days come, days go, seasons pass. And I travel from being impressed and terrified to being forgetful and occupied. I do the synagogue thing more out of religious ritual than spiritual reality. Any hint of his glory only magnifies how off limits he is and feeds my doubt. And I'm fickle at this. It only takes an instant for me to go from terrified to uncertain to dull to smug. I'll tell you a second reason I was sad and scared that night. Too much light, overexposure. Could you imagine how pathetic I looked? If you really want to know the truth about me, I love the darkness rather than the light. We who do evil things hate the light for fear that our deeds will be exposed. I can be irritating and ornery, but never considered myself that bad. Not until that light. Before that moment, I thought that God had nothing on me. Even if he cared, it would be his excessive presumption to hint that I deserve his wrath. What kind of God would be upset with me? Yes, these are not well-mannered sheep, and I am no showered shepherd, but come on, this is over the top, this light on the situation. So I had two problems. While the glory of the Lord shone around us, he was too far, inexplicable, not knowable, and he was too close, exposing me for who I am. So I was scared. The creator who couldn't know because he would have nothing to do with me. The creator I didn't want to know because of what he would do to me. Not good. I tell you, the only thing that made sense at that moment was silence. There, my buddies and I stood in awe, in shame, in terror, every mouth silenced as if we and the whole world were held accountable to God. I had underestimated perfection, nor did I take into account that his deserved holiness was preparing me for something unimaginably better. All I realized right then was that my most recent sin, and the next, each sin on its own, is sufficient to damn the entire human race and to send all to hell. The stakes are beyond high. My problem was worsening by the second. This must be dying, like I was looking outside in, seeing myself not in polite unreality, but in bold truth, quiet, utterly dependent on his verdict. The next move was his. The thought hit me that whatever comes of this episode in my life, whatever he decides to do with me, however this turns out, let God be found true, though I may be found a liar. He will be justified and will prevail. I was beginning to agree with God and to disagree with myself. And the angel said to us, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of a great joy, which shall be for all the people." Do not be afraid. How did you know? How did you do that? I was just suffocating, dying, really. How did we get to security so fast? This is weird. Am I about to get out of another quandary just like that? Where's the punishment? Aren't there rules, God? Standards? Don't you know who you are, God? But I held those thoughts. This was no time to speak. For today, in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. When in a fog, signage is good. Helps me find my bearings. How intriguing. The sign is not a great warrior or a document, but a baby. Now you're talking. Could this be a deliberate shrinking of omnipotence? Word of the Father now in flesh appearing, a thrill of hope, the weary world rejoices, a tenacious personalism at the heart of this night, born of you, born for me? No way. He is born for the world, to bring goodness to the world. His agenda concerns the nations, not the everydayness of me. There are many me's out there for whom he cares. I don't register on the important scale. Mine is a life that just fades in the background. Others don't notice. I move along anonymously with my kids and acquaintances. I pay the bills, remember the birthdays, and just carry on in this average life. Notice mostly in those myriad of instances when I let others down and just don't measure up. I am a dirty shepherd, disenfranchised, despised as a class, and culturally unclean. Mine is not an ideal life. Mine is an actual life. There I stood, uncovered, average, worse than average, a disappointment to myself, to God, loathing me, dreading God. And suddenly, there appeared with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men with whom he is pleased." Yes, peace on earth. No bad storms, no more wars, right? No, it really isn't that, is it? What on earth is happening? Check that. What in me is happening? You mean peace with you, don't you? No more dreading you, somehow enjoying you. Did you say favored, pleased with me? Not rejected, but welcomed? Not avoiding you, but longing for you? But just look at me. What a mess. This stunning illumination only proves my ineptitude and leaves me to my own resources. The heavenly host had said that they had to say, then vanished. It was as if the celestial celebrators were making their rounds, stopping by to taunt me as part of my punishment, that before I die of my sins, I got to see what I was missing. Getting in one last jab before lights out for me. The heavenly host praising God and saying, "Press release, we told you so, eat our dust. Have fun down there reaping what you've sown. Check you later." Or did they say, "Peace with men with whom he is pleased"? Interesting, complicated. If that's the case, the solution must come from somewhere else. I got nothing. I don't have what it takes. There must be another, a sign. A baby. I have peace with God through this sign. Favor rests on me through this sign. A baby wrapped in cloths. I looked at my buddies. They looked at me. I don't know who said it first. "Let us go straight to Bethlehem and see the thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And we came in haste and found our way to Mary and Joseph and the baby as he lay in the manger. You know, in my absurdity meets his greatness, I am silent. When he points me to his son, I get moving. Finally, faithful obedience. Wind in my sails. I was made for this. Me being me, but being his at the same time. Fog lifting, purpose-driven life. Something from without, solving all the somethings within. We didn't just drop our staffs and run. We planned as we left. We got word to our families. We devised contingencies for the sheep. All those details, you know, the nuisances trying to leave town, but meaningful. Since then, many ordinary days have been just like that. We found our way to Mary and Joseph and the baby as he lay in the manger. When I met the babe, I knew God is right, and I am wrong. His righteousness revealed, his rightness for me. Kneeling that night, I realized I would get out of my quandary, and yet he would not lower his standards. There would be my complete punishment, but it passed over me and fell squarely on his perfect, cooing, royal infant. This child who would live the life that qualified him for the death that he died at the cross, where God's wrath and mercy met and settled the only score that matters, all to my advantage. Just as if I never sinned. Yes, but with a cost. Beyond benevolent, his kindness leads me to repentance. He cast out my sin and entered in. He was born in me that night. God appeased. Hallelujah. But the heavenly host was explicit. He is pleased. Not an impersonal pardon or just a judicious act, but a fatherly embrace. I had the thought that if I was ever pardoned, I still expected to feel ongoing rejection somehow by the Father, a kind of reluctant forgiveness on his part based on his passing mood or inattention to my screw-ups. But no. God says, "I forgive you, I am permanently appeased, and I love you, I am permanently pleased." You'd think We became priests that day, but no, just beloved shepherds. We went back glorifying and praising God for all that he had heard, that we had heard and seen, just as had been told us. We went from paralyzed, silent shepherds to lively, loquacious sons. Where'd we go? To our families, to our routines, to our suffering, to our sin, to our work. After all, we had to connect with the buddy we left back with the sheep. We did not resign our positions or go into the ministry, but we had become king's kids in shepherd form. We remained in the position that we were called, not motionless from dullness and fear, but with a yip in our step, steady, engaged. Becoming innocent changes your life. Wonderfully, you are not put back to neutral as if your next sin will blow it all. I have permanent innocence. What's more, presence, power, hope, eternal life, to name a few. What Adam brought, Christ brought so much more. Where sin increases, grace abounds all the more. What sin depletes, God nourishes with reams of baskets left over. And so, I live. God more real and present, experiencing him with deeper and quicker facing of my sin, my need, my gifts. Me, more me than ever. But all that conflict, suffering, and sin, all those blessings and wonders, all that hate and love converge into life robust in God. I see the extraordinary in the ordinary. The potential in a derisive person or situation, and my role in kingdom building, but learning not to take myself too seriously. I can even embrace my suffering, knowing it produces endurance and proven character, which leads to hope, as one day I will experience fully who I fully am now, a child of the living God. And this hope does not disappoint. It has an active role presently as God keeps pouring his love in my heart through the Holy Spirit who has been given to me. God, not a remote abstraction from the conditions of life, but an intimate presence. He concurrently shines his light on my absurdity and points me to his Son. Let's go see. Let's get our eyes elsewhere. For today, in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior who is Christ the Lord. Lord God, I thank you that you left heaven and came to earth. I thank you that you have made possible grace, mercy, forgiveness, justification, pardon of sin. You have given us hope, purpose, a way where there is no way. You have made eternal life our end if we trust you. And so, Father, I pray for anyone here this evening who does not yet know you as Lord and Savior. I pray, God, that you would open their hearts, their minds, their eyes, their lives to the truth about you. I pray that theirs would not just be a life of going through the motions or even occasionally moving through with religious ritual, but that their life would be a testimony of your grace lived for your glory, giving you the honor, praise, love, and devotion that you so deserve. Recognizing that when we all live that way, Lord, we are most satisfied. We are most joyful. Our life counts for more, and we recognize who you are and who we are. And so, Lord, I pray that you would encourage us this evening to be more like you and to trust you as never before. And I pray it in your holy, precious, and matchless name, the name of Jesus. Amen. Again, I want to say thank you for coming this evening. And I truly do hope that you have a blessed Christmas. We count it a privilege to have worshiped with you here. We are going to sing two more songs before we go. And I would just encourage you, don't just sing from the lips out. Sing from the heart up. Ask God to cause you to make a joyful noise as you sing these praises to him. Would you stand? Let's sing together.
Come, let us adore him.
You a Merry Christmas, and there's also a gift for you all on the way out. Grab a little treat as you go.